Time now for a rink demo presented by Bauer, Scott Braun, Alex Tanguay, and Stu Grimson. And we're all physical dudes, so we like a little traffic in front
of
the net.
Yeah, we don't mind
we?
A little traffic
Why
in front.
Not? So what's the best way to create that traffic? Because there are many different scenarios that play out in the NHL.
There really are, and we see more and more today, Tangs. You know what it's like? We see a lot of goals. I mean, I would almost estimate the majority of goals coming off some kind of traffic in and around the front of the net. So for a forward, you know, at the position you and I play, we need to kind of think about in our head, given the rules, how do we provide effective net front traffic? Because it's a risky area and there's a lot at stake in this area. Let's just start with kind of a basic understanding of the rule, because this trips up coaches, players, and broadcasters in some cases too. But really the guiding principle in this area is, in this blue paint, this is the goaltender's territory, right? And we have this principle. The goaltender needs to be able to move about freely inside that paint to make a save. Then that's not to say you can't come in here from time to time. If there's a scoring chance, I can come in. If I get knocked in, as long as I get right back out again, I'm okay to come into that space. But if I go into that space and I create contact, even accidentally, with the goaltender, then I run the risk of getting a goal called back against me. So let's look at a situation that happened in the Boston-Carolina series just a couple of nights ago. And this really helps paint the explanation right here. It'll involve Jake DeBrusk. Got to get that out of my head. Jake DeBrusk is providing that net front traffic right in and around the paint in this area right here. And notice, goaltender McElhinney is clearly established in that area. And by kind of entering this area up here, notice now, DeBrusk has a decision to make right here in this area. Goaltender hovering out towards the top of that paint. Slavin is very close to that paint, the defender. He's got to make a decision. Do I go through here? If I do, it's a really narrow area. I run the risk of making contact with that goaltender. Or do I go around Slavin and provide that net front traffic? Go ahead and run it forward, guys. You can see he gets squeezed out. Our goaltender, McElhinney, is still clearly, or at least the majority of him, is still in that paint. And that's at the moment DeBrusk makes contact with him. He's got those Supreme 25 Bauer skates on, Tangs, and he gets him a little tangled up with the goaltender. Here it is, a look on the backside. Really interesting angle as well. Notice how tight that lane is between McElhinney and DeBrusk, and then again, a defender on the other side of him, Slavin on the other side. A decision has to be made. Go ahead and roll it forward from there, guys. DeBrusk's got to do a better job of. He's got to make, do I run the risk of making contact with that goaltender if I go through that very narrow opening right here? Or do I go around and try to provide that traffic? So it's an interesting question, a tough question. And you can see the consequences, because Tangs, from a defender's point of view, you'll try and game the system a little bit from time to time.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you're going to be DeBrusk and you're on that side of me, and I'm Jacob Slavin, and the positioning was great here because I know that my feet are right on top of the crease. Yeah. I know where DeBrusk is at. So now if he doesn't want to, you know, if he wants to get in that position where he's going to go between, you know, McElhinney and me,
exactly,
all I have to do is give him a little push like that. So it's not me pushing him, but now he's got to impede, he's got to interfere with the netminder. And if he goes the other way, if he goes the front route, then I'm just guiding him with my stick and I'm guiding him out of the way.
Try to hold me to the outside.
Hold him out, and then Tore Krug will take that shot, which will be an easy stop for McElhinney.
Yeah.
But, you know, the defensive side of it, you know, the players on the attack, they have to realize where the defenseman at and how to find that positioning, because, like Stu mentioned, the blue paint, if you want to score goals in the NHL, that's where you have to be. That's where somebody on your team has to go to allow your team to score some goals.
Yeah, exactly right. And from the attacking player's point of view, I've got to make a gauge. I've got to gauge the play. I've got to try to judge, how close is that goaltender to the top of the paint? How close is this defender to the top of the paint? Does that create a lane for me to get through without making contact with that goaltender and running the risk of a goal being called back against us? Or do I take the more conservative, go around on this side? It's kind of a tricky play. You've got to read it in a split second, but there's a lot at stake. It's a goal called back against you. Now, let's not pick on DeBrusk, because there's many, many opportunities where he provides really effective net front traffic. Roll some of that, you guys. He's a big body, occupies that space exceptionally well, and here are instances where he's created a good amount of buffer, a good amount of space between he and the opposing netminder, Mrazek in that case. Look at the separation between he and Mrazek at that point. mindful that Mrazek, hold it there, guys. Mrazek is still in that blue paint. If he retreats back and makes contact with Mrazek while he's in that area, he runs the risk of having a goal called back.
And this, too, for me, is the perfect example because the young kids watching at home, take notice of that. Jake DeBrus is not right when he's by himself and Slavin, there's nobody around. Let's say, Stu, that you're the goalie. I'm not right on top of, you know, the goalie right here. I create myself some separation because if I tip the puck now, then the goalie's got, there's reaction, there's time for the puck to move. And if there's a rebound, then all of a sudden I'm not stuck to the goalie where, you know, the defenseman is going to be coming this way, right? Slavin is in this position.
Yeah.
If I get the rebound and I have to skate out like this, there's no way Slavin's not getting to me. But if I'm out this way, now all of a sudden I've got body position, I've got room. Slavin's going to come and push me. No problem. I'm going to roll with the check. I'm still in a position where I'll protect it. That will allow me to put the puck in the back of the net.
Here's a good rule for the attacking forward. If I'm providing net front traffic, take a look below you. If you don't see blue paint, you're probably in a good spot. And then allow a little buffer, a little layer of, say, a foot and a half. Take a look at, and in this case, DeBrus, his Bauer Pro Supreme 25 skates underneath him. Take a look down there. If that's white ice plus a little buffer, you're probably in a good spot. If you get too far back, you run the risk of, again, making that contact and having the call go against you.
Okay, so traffic, physicality, yes, that's involved. But it's also a thinking man's game.
Oh, it is.
Much more than people think.
High-functioning athletes these hockey players are.
We've learned a lot. That is your Rink Demo presented by Bauer.
Become the player you've always dreamed of with My Bauer custom skates, sticks, and goal equipment. You can visit Bauer.com to learn more.